There are three things you can do to help us out.
One, you can make sure you subscribe to this channel.
Two is you can leave a comment here or on Apple Podcasts.
And three, if you really want to help, you can follow this link to see how you could be a supporter on Patreon.
Word in Your Attic, a Zoom with a View.
Well, welcome to another Word in Your Attic, and we're delighted to be joined on this day of all days by film director and writer Edgar Wright, and the director of Shaun of the Dead, Hot Fuzz, Baby Driver, and today, your Sparks documentary. Tell us, what does a film director do on the day a film comes out?
Well, today, actually, what's nice is I've done like a million interviews for this film with Ron and Russell. But tonight is the first like Q&A that we're doing for the movie on stage together, because of the pandemic. They've been in Los Angeles, I've been in London, and they're in London now. So it's actually really sweet. It's on the day that it comes out, we finally get to do a Q&A on the same stage together, because for a long until like just having lunch with them, like this weekend, I had not seen them in the flesh since late 2019. Like, so I finished the whole movie. Like, we never got to watch it together for the first time. So tonight's kind of special because not only is it the premiere, but I actually get to be with them for once.
Very good. Very good. Well, look, you've kindly spared us the time to go through your musical back pages. And well, I'm sure we'll come to Sparks again later on in the
at some length.
And, so first of all, the traditional question we all start by asking is, can you remember the music playing equipment that was in your home when you were a child?
I do not remember what I can see it and I can visualize it. I cannot remember what the brand of record player was that my parents had. But basically, from a very early age, my parents used to kind of like work a lot. They were like both like comprehensive teachers, art teachers, and also they were artists as well. And at some points they're kind of like holding down like more than one job. So I think from the age of four onwards, I certainly figured out how to use the record player myself.
Right.
So I would like just listen to their record collection. And then also the occasional thing that my parents had bought for me and my brother.
What kind of stuff did they have? Can you remember?
I have some of it right here.
Oh, go on, let's see.
We want to see.
Excellent.
Well, here's the funny thing about my parents' record collection, because I think this then informed what I would listen to in my teenage years, because they basically had one record box only, and it didn't seem to get any bigger than what would fit in one record box. And also, it seemed to be, with a couple of exceptions, which I'll go into, it seemed to stop dead when my parents had me and my brother.
Yeah, there you go.
So they kind of like, it's mostly 60s stuff, but mostly around like sort of early 70s. My brother was born in 72. I was born in 74. Then it kind of stops dead. And in a weird way, when I was a teenager, even though I was very into like, I would listen to all the top 40 stuff and be well aware of pop music in like the 80s and 90s. But I would sort of gravitate towards the albums, sometimes of bands that were still going, but like of people sort of slightly before my time, or even albums that were slightly before I was born, because I felt maybe I was like trying to continue my parents' record collection.
Right.
What they probably would have bought if they hadn't had me and my brother, which was kind of like Bowie and Queen and Roxy Music and T-Rex. And then, you know, this is where Sparks comes into it a little bit as well. But I'll show you what they did have, because what's funny is like what they do have, and it's funny what they don't have. So Beatles, for starters.
Right.
But what's funny about the Beatles one, and by the way, and then, of course, as you might imagine, once you've got the Beatles albums at home, even like from the age of four onwards, just a source of like obsession. But what's funny to me is I'll show you the Beatles albums they did, and then you can see which key one is missing. First Beatles album, Rubber Soul.
Nothing wrong with that.
Right.
Nothing wrong with that.
All good.
Second Beatles album that they had, let me stress, would be, I'm going to go in chronological order. Then,
okay. Yeah, that
already. And then And then this is, I think, quite rare. In fact, this is the mono.
Yeah, the EP. That's brilliant.
The mono Sergeant
Pepper. That's the mono Sergeant Pepper. That's the way we all listen to it.
Yeah.
This is the Magical Mystery Tour EP, which I gather
with
the
wonderful booklet. That's quite rare. It is.
Yeah, it is quite rare. And it's, and I used to be obsessed with the photo long before I actually saw it of John Lennon feeding the lady spaghetti.
Oh, yes.
With a fork. That's right. Yeah.
Then we got, obviously, the White Album.
Borrowed by Monty Python, I think, that guy.
Yeah. Very Mr. Creosote.
It is.
The White Album, also, with all of the photos inside.
Oh, what's the number? What's the number, Edgar? It's got a...
It's number 0537039.
Oh, that's very rare.
Oh my lord, that's rare. Well, one copy went for $798,000, didn't it? Although I think the number was slightly.
Got all the photos inside.
Oh, really? Oh, wow! Amazing. Has he got the poster? Has he got the big poster?
Let's have a look. It's got the.
There should be a wall poster.
A wall poster
which has bizarre photographs of John Lennon, I think, naked making a telephone call. Things he used to come just disturb me when I was a kid.
But then Abbey Road, and then Let It Be.
Right.
And it wasn't until years later when I started to kind of read music magazines that you guys worked on, that I was like, said to my mum and dad, said, hey, why did you never buy Revolver?
Was there a reason?
They just said, we never got round to that one. And I think it was around the time maybe Mojo had called it at one point the best album of all time, Revolver.
I said,
you guys have not got the... So I actually bought them Revolver on CD like a long time afterwards because it was the one they were missing. And then obviously all of the pre-Beatles, like pre-Rubber Soul albums, they didn't have either.
Right.
Yeah. So it was sort of... And then what's weird is they only had one Rolling Stones album, the first one.
There's nothing wrong with that.
No, it's a brilliant record, that is. Yeah, I used to Carol,
it's all brilliant because it's all other people's songs,
but it's funny that they had this one and none of the other ones.
Well, if you're only gonna have I wouldn't blame anybody for
and then I'll run through a couple of other ones. I'll get into like the rare 70s ones they had. Are you like these ones? This is obviously a classic Motown.
Number three. Which one? Three, is that three? I got Behind a Painted Smile on it, I think it is.
It does. It has, Heard It Through the Grapevine.
Absolutely.
My Sherry and More.
That's the one everybody took to parties in 1968 or whatever.
Yeah, and it has the cool kind of lenticular
cover.
This one, Otis.
Oh, nothing wrong with that.
Otis Blue.
Yeah.
And then this is where it starts to stop. And this is where, Bridge Over Troubled Water, the only one that they had of Simon and Garfunkel.
It's compulsory. Everybody had to have it by law. Every single house
had one at the time.
And also, this ended up inspiring one of my movies because obviously this is the...
Baby Driver.
Absolutely.
And I got to meet... Paul Simon a couple of years ago because I went to one of his final Madison Square Garden gigs.
Right.
And I knew that, I knew that he knew about the film because obviously we had to clear the track. And I think also because the film was called that, I had to write a letter to Paul Simon and everything. But you never quite know whether somebody's seen it. And so I was quite, and his manager had certainly seen it and loved the movie. I didn't know whether Paul Simon had as well. And so there was that thing, I went to see the gig and then the manager said, oh, come backstage and meet Paul. And that was very nerve-wracking because I had no idea whether Paul Simon had seen the movie or even if he had seen it, did he like it? I was nervous to A, meet Paul Simon, and B, is like, did he see the movie? Did he like the movie? And then when I was backstage, weirdly, I went with Paul Rudd, the actor, the two of us went together. And then he saw me and he goes, well, Edgar, I loved your movie. I always thought Baby Driver was a good title. And obviously you proved that it was true. And I said, oh, the reason I called it that is because as a young kid, reading the lyrics of Baby Driver in a sort of, when you're very young, sort of pre kind of any sort of sexual awareness at all, you're reading these lyrics like, what is this song about? Vaguely sexual, you're kind of sort of like the lyric, I'm not talking about your pigtails, I'm talking about your sex appeal. When you're reading that age five, it's like, what does that mean? So and then I said to him that I said to him that one of the reasons I wrote it is because I was kind of curious about the lyrics. And then he started in front of us, like breaking down the song, which was like singing bits of it and sort of explaining, like he literally starts to go, he goes, well, you know, my daddy was the family bass man. My dad played the bass. My mama was an engineer. Well, she wasn't an engineer, but she did work in the kind of forces. And so I was kind of, my mind was being blown as like, oh my God. I mean, also that kind of thing where you can't take a video of it. It's not cool to, but it's like, oh, I wish I could record this moment, but I can't.
Yeah.
So I didn't even get a photo of us together because I thought it would be too uncool in his dressing room to say, I just couldn't bring myself to bring down the vibe by saying, Paul, you don't mind if we get quick.
He's not a selfie person, is he, Paul Simon?
I didn't get that vibe, but he was very nice. Yes. You know, he quickly started talking about taking ayahuasca. And that was a whole other anecdote. It was just like, I can't believe I'm in this room.
All right. So when did you start buying records for yourself? Can you remember what you first bought for yourself?
Well, I just to show you a couple of others.
Yeah, go on.
Because these are the things where there's one funny. The other thing, this is more my dad continuing a little bit into the 70s, is my dad was very much Genesis, but only Peter Gabriel Genesis.
Okay.
So, like, sort of
a purist.
And then this one, as a kid, the inlay
Sound
Broadway used to scare the shit out of me. And I think I never like listened to it because the thing on the back with the man with no mouth, when I was like 4 or 5, it used to really terrify me. And I don't think I listened to this for a long time. And then this is the last album that my dad had. It was like, this is Pete Gabriel's first album, right?
Oh, yeah, it is. Yeah.
Off the Hill. And so then in terms of what I would get, like they would occasionally buy me and my brother like singles and then some other albums that I have here. I'd like to, maybe I should talk about a couple of those before.
Go on.
I'm delaying because the first single I bought with my own money is embarrassing.
It's never embarrassing.
But that's been a running theme on these recordings, actually, and we applaud it. Don't get the Wombles are very much back in fashion, believe you me.
But I guess prior to having pocket money where, like, me and my brother would actually buy singles, the other thing, that, and this is key to the documentary, that my parents would get us is these kind of, like, Ronco K-Tel.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, my God, that's a period piece.
Yeah, no, weirdly enough, it was actually through Pete Perfidi's book that just came out. In reading that book, it unlocked in my head the name of the names of the K-Tel compilations that I had, which are probably long gone to these are not my original ones. I actually re-bought them all on Discogs. the other ones had gone to the charity shop a long, long time ago. But I realized that this particular one, it's from 1979, is the first vinyl I ever had of Sparks.
And when I
bought this off Discogs, which only cost like less than 10 quid in perfect nick. But what's amazing is the sequencing on these albums is utterly bonkers. And in a weird way, I realized in a pre-algorithm age, like, if I had an eclectic music taste, it's probably because these Ronco K-Tel chart albums, listen to this sequencing, Dollar, followed by The Ruts, followed by Public Image, followed by Racy.
That's it.
Literally, Death Disco by Public Image goes into Lay Your Love on Me by Racy. And I was listening to this when I was like 5 years old. So, and I listened to it again, I was thinking, who on earth thought that was a good segue between those two songs?
Well, it was only like listening to the chart show, wasn't it, really?
Yeah, they're watching charts. The pops, exactly.
Everything's in there, isn't it? That's the
deal. So how old when you discovered Sparks? You say 5?
Yeah.
What did you make of them then? Because, I mean, that's a really complicated group with all those strange references to make any sense of when you're 5.
Well,
Dollar and Racy, I understand.
I'm not going to pretend that I was cool enough to say when I first saw Sparks that they're my favorite band. But what I do really remember, aside from having this album had Beat the Clock on it. And then the other one I had this had When I'm With You by Sparks on it.
Yeah.
But what I do remember is that because I started watching Top of the Pops very young and it would always be on, you know, be a big event in the house as it was, you know, when a third of the nation are watching it.
Yeah.
And, I do remember that Sparks, the thing I really remember about it is that sort of sandwich between like the Nolans and ABBA, like sparks kind of like staring down the camera at you. Not, and not just Ron Mael, Russell as well, was like a really like disconcerting proposition in the
face. Like,
you're watching it and you're thinking, am I in trouble? What's happening? Why are these? And it is that thing, I think,
with hovering parents thinking Adolf Hitler is in our living room, you know?
Yeah. I mean, I think it was also more the thing of like the kind of the dissonance between it being really catchy and upbeat and like Ron, like sort of like doing nothing and staring at him, but also like Russell, like staring. I mean, it was, I mean, obviously we cover it in the documentary because it goes further back to like the early 70s, but he, you know, in that pre-punk era, it's definitely one, I think, one of the first kind of like anti-pop like gestures, like in terms of when they, I think that's the thing, when they were on like sort of the 74 Top of the Pops, the famous like This Town appearance, like it's all the other glam bands and stuff are all like smiles, like Mud and Sweet and, you know, even T-Rex and stuff, but like sort of like Ron and Russell are just like sort of, yeah. Yeah. It's just like completely kind of like this kind of poker face performance that's why it feels like something's happening. And I felt that even as a 5-year-old watching it, is that there's something like going on here that I don't quite understand.
But it's an amazing combination of sincerity and also self-lampooning, isn't it, at the same time? Bizarre.
I think that's the thing that people get wrong about them the most. And I'm glad you just said that, because I think that the thing about them, which I think sometimes people get wrong, or maybe what's kept them, keeps some audience members at arm's length, is that because there's humor to it, they assume that that is insincere. When I think the thing about Sparks is that they are like really serious about what they do, even if they're like sometimes making fun of the form. Like the emotion is kind of like sincere. And so I think that's something about them that people kind of like sort of sometimes misconstrue, is that they, you know, like maybe their biggest detractors would say, oh, are they like a novelty band? I don't get it. Is it supposed to be a joke? But it's not. It's just like that, you know, like in as we talk about a lot in the documentary, in music, some people just don't like comedy in their music, full stop. But there's like, Sparks are not the Baron Knights, you know? Like,
no,
it's like, it's a different thing.
So what did you learn about them from making the movie that made you appreciate them even more? You must have discovered all sorts of extraordinary things. So you've interviewed a lot of people for it.
Well, I think the thing, even before I started, and maybe one of the things that gave me the inkling about doing it is I had gotten to know them a little bit in Los Angeles, maybe about 2 years before I suggested doing the documentary. And the thing that I was really impressed, there's that thing about don't meet your heroes and the idea of pulling back the curtain and it being, you know, kind of not quite as exciting meeting the real person behind the artist. And Sparks seemed like one of those strange bands that, like, on one hand, the more normal they were made them seem weird. And also that they seemed like they were never off the clock. That there was this thing, and like having met musicians over the years, the thing with Ron and Russell is like the line between them and Sparks has become permanently blurred. And they do seem, you see it in the documentary, sort of almost monastic in their like Sparks and just working really hard and so working on it every day. Like, and that's something like is just kind of extraordinary to me, because I don't think I've ever met another musician or myself that seems as committed to what they're doing. And so I was very aware of that. And I thought that and it sort of flies in the face of like most other music documentaries, or even because a lot of other music documentaries, it's usually the thing where it's a more established act. And then the thing will be like, hear the tragic story behind the music.
Yes.
But yeah. In a weird way, the story of Sparks is that they just work really hard. That's why there's like 25 albums, and that's why they keep plugging away, is because they're in a weird way, that, as they say themselves, is like the drama is on the record. You know, yeah. Like one of the reasons they don't like to talk about their private lives as much is that they genuinely say, what we do on the record is much more interesting than what's happening at home. And we'd rather people, we're proud of that. And we'd rather people concentrate on that, because that's in a weird way that thing of like, that's their expression. And anything that they kind of, so there's that thing where, I mean, I find, especially in the recent albums, I find it amazing where it almost becomes like a sort of Curb Your Enthusiasm approach, where Ronald Russell would take some kind of little observation of life and make it into like opera. But that again is that thing, is that it might be something that they observe in a restaurant that they may even not vocalize aloud, but then go home and write like a 6-minute like epic about it. And that again is that it's more, it, you know, what you see in the documentary of their kind of like life in Los Angeles in terms of their routine is I'm not hiding anything. That's exactly what it's like. And it's a bit like that Einstein thing of where Einstein would wear the same clothes and eat the same lunch every day so that all of his mental energy is in his work and not thinking about what he's having for lunch. And Sparks are sort of similar, where they kind of, they keep it very like, is it sort of, they have this regimen so that kind of, so they can, on record, they can sort of explode, you know?
And they were fantastic at inventing their own mythology, weren't they, back in the day? I can remember them putting out something about how they were the sons of Doris Day, you know. For yeah. decades, people believed this because there was no internet to be able to disprove it. And it was, I love that.
The sons of Doris Day, the other one was that they were former hand models.
That's right, yeah. That's great. So you wouldn't have recognised them anyway. That's right, yeah.
So clearly, you know, you've been very fortunate in your career that you've been able to kind of indulge your personal musical taste, that fair to say? And then Sparks is the case, is the ultimate case of this, is it?
No, it's one of the nice things in the other movies, especially something like Baby Driver, which is like wall-to-wall music, is that you get to kind of conceive scenes around your favorite. I'm still stalling on my first ever single ever bought, but we'll come back.
Right, okay.
All right, good.
Embarrassing. You get to kind of like use your favorite songs and conceive scenes around them, and or even in some cases, like I have another movie coming out this year called Last Night in Soho, and that is all conceived around a particular period. So it's kind of like a gift sometimes, where there's like, you know, the film is partly set in the 60s, so just having that brief of like, okay, this is going to be like a mid 60s soundtrack, and that is just, even when there's that kind of like sort of strictures on it, that's a brilliant thing, because it's like, okay, this is a particular kind of time and genre that I'm gonna cover in this. But it's been amazing, and it also, like, as a music fan, it sort of made the world smaller in a lot of ways, because, you know, frequently if something kind of really hits in a movie, you know, the artist usually hears about it, and sometimes I've got to meet some of my favorite artists through that, which has been, you know, just amazing.
I couldn't believe it. I was looking at, I'm sorry, I've been mixed up with which of your films. I was looking at one of your films recently where you use just the bit where Reg Presley, I think, says, "Oh no," from some Troggs song. Just that on its own.
It's in Hot Fuzz.
Okay. Brilliant.
It's just absolutely. I thought to myself, did he know he could clear this at the time that you shot that and edited that? Because it must be, you must have to deal with a lot of that kind of thing, must you?
Yeah, I mean, usually if something's really integral, like the smart thing, if something's really integral, like, for example, in Shaun of the Dead, we use Queen's Don't Stop Me Now, and it's like integral to the scene, yeah, in the sense that they even refer to the fact that it's playing. Like, the key is to any low budget filmmaker or anything is like, don't film the scene unless you have the track. Otherwise, you're going to be like really embarrassed when you can't use it. So I think early on learned that lesson. And then with some of the movies, especially Baby Driver, like, because in Baby Driver, we played the songs in on set, like, so people are listening to the songs and sometimes singing along with them, or it's all choreographed. So we didn't shoot any of those scenes without clearing the track. It's just like, you're in kind of a world of hurt if, you know, you're on the other side.
There's a great bit of Baby Driver where you use, I think it's John Spencer Blues Explosion. Is it bell bottoms? I'm trying to remember now. So lovely to be able to kind of get a big check sent in the direction of someone whose music you really like. It must be a nice feeling.
Yeah, I mean, what's funny is that I'd actually, John Spencer actually did a couple of songs for Hot Fuzz. I'm a big Blues Explosion fan. And then I'd always had this idea around bell bottoms in that movie, in a sense of like, almost like the inspiration for the entire movie was listening to that song for the first time when it first came out in like 94 or whatever. I'd almost like have this kind of action.
You just visualized it. Yeah.
Synesthesia, like, where it's like, I can't listen to that song without thinking of this car chase. And then years and years later, I think when I was starting to do Baby Driver, and I said to John Spencer, I said, oh, you know, we're going to use like bell bottoms in like the the movie, and he's like, oh, great, great. In that way that you kind of think, maybe like the Troggs thing in Hot Fuzz, like you hear the intro and then it fades out. And then it was actually like John hadn't seen it yet, but one of the other members, Judah Bauer, the guitarist, had seen another screening. And then I think he told John Spencer, he goes, do you know how much Bell Bottoms is in Baby Driver? when he saw it, I don't think he was quite prepared for like, and I had a similar experience actually, Brian May, because Brighton Rock is in Baby Driver. And when I met him at a sort of at the theater, and I knew he liked the movie because he tweeted about it. And so I went up and said, oh, I'm Edgar Wright, director of Baby Driver. And he said the same thing as John Spencer. He goes, when I saw that movie, I knew Brighton Rock was going to be in it. I just assumed you're going to play the intro and it's going to fade out. And as the scene is going on, I was thinking like, wait, he's really going to play the whole of Brighton Rock. And he goes, I literally couldn't believe it. He goes, nobody ever does that. And I said, well, that's the sort of point of the movie. It's like every scene is like the whole song, you know? Right. So, I mean, it's been such a gift to do scenes around stuff. I mean, weirdly, I'd never used sparks in a movie. And I realized there was a good reason for it. So I tried to use a spark song in Hot Fuzz. This Town Ain't Big Enough for the Both of Us, in a scene where Timothy Dalton and Simon Pegg are fighting in a model village. And I tried the song on the scene, and then something happened that like was a credit to Sparks, but eventually bumped them off the soundtrack. I couldn't watch the scene without listening to Sparks. And I realized it's like, Sparks, this is a credit to them. They're not like wallpaper. It's not, you can't easily put it on something without starting to think about it. So it was something where it couldn't just be on in the background. And so I in a weird way, I'd never use them in a film, and maybe the documentary is me making up for that.
So your first single.
Yes, come on.
Show us your first single.
I don't have it. I think that one is long gone, but it was Tight Fits, Lion Sleeps Tonight.
Yeah, that's a good record.
See, that's real.
Great record.
That's real.
What happened was,
in the jungle, the mighty jungle. That's brilliant.
The same week, me and my brother both went to the local record shop. I grew up in Wells in Somerset, and the local record shop, we both went there, and my brother got to the counter before me and bought the one that I really wanted. So Lion Sleeps Tonight was like my B choice, but he bought what would have been my first choice, which was Jay Giles' band Centerfold.
Oh,
so I was kind of mad at my brother that he beat me to the cooler one of the two.
That's brilliant.
And you remember the first gig you ever went to?
Yes. I'm going to discount what I would call a children's gig. But the children's gig, because I wouldn't call this a proper rock concert, but I did see Derek Griffiths. At Strode Theatre in Somerset. But let's discount that one. The first proper rock gig, the first three that I went to is a pretty good going for the first three gigs. I didn't really go to a proper concert until I was 16, but the first one was David Bowie at Milton Keynes Bowl. So that was the first concert.
That's amazing.
It was. Yeah. The second one was Prince at Earl's Court. And the third one was Spinal Tap at the Royal Albert Hall. Oh, that's a pretty good, like, that was pretty four not quite so cool.
So you've never been in the band yourself?
No, and I think maybe the amount of music in my films is me just because I'm envious of people that are in bands. Right. Unlike Ron Mael, my I did take piano lessons when I was like five, and then I'm not expecting like the violin strings, but my parents had to sell the piano.
Oh,
so we had an upright, and then they had to sell it, and then that was the end of piano lessons. So, but I maybe it's not too late to take up an instrument.
So, talking about music and films, I think Martin Scorsese, didn't he use "Jump Into the Fire" by Harry Nilsson at the end of Goodfellas?
Yeah.
And I think he said in an interview, he'd been carrying it around from film to film over the years, thinking, I'm going to make it fit into something.
That's right, trying to accommodate it.
Have you got something like that? And if you have, is it a secret?
Well, yes. I mean, in weirdly what you were talking about, clearance stuff, you don't necessarily want people to know what song you really want to use. But sometimes there are songs where, in a weird way, in a sort of roundabout way, there'll be songs where I'll link a song with a project. And then sometimes if I hear that song again, like if it comes up on shuffle, it will literally make me think, I have to make that movie. And I'll tell you one song that's in Last Night in Soho that whenever it would like pop up, I would think, I have to make that movie, is There's a Ghost in My House by R. Dean Taylor.
Taylor, wow.
So I love that song. And I think I found that song because I'd heard the Fools cover version first. And then I found the original one, which is just amazing. And then it's that thing as I'd had this idea for this film for like literally a decade. But whenever There's a Ghost in My House would pop up, I'd be going, oh, I got to make that movie.
Yes.
So that would happen as well.
And you must be terrified that another film director is going to do it first.
Yes, that does sometimes happen where somebody, and sometimes there's even some other film directors, like James Gunn is a friend of mine. And I remember when Baby Driver was coming out and he had Guardians of the Galaxy 2 coming out. We had this kind of like little text conversation where we were just kind of like feeling each other out, saying like, you don't have any Barry White in your film, right? He goes, you don't have any ELO in your film, do you? I was like, so we just like, without saying the titles of the songs, we were just trying to kind of figure out, because it would be an embarrassing thing if, like, you came out in the same summer and it's like, oh, we both did a big set piece to Mr. Blue Sky. That's a bummer.
And I suppose your film director contemporaries, peers, they're all similarly interested in music like you are. You know, they've all got a head full of specific things they remember that they've wanted to use. Is that the case?
Yeah, and I guess like, you know, I guess there was a certain... To me, I remember the films as well where I was first like aware of like pop music or even existing music in films. Like, I guess, you know, growing up, like probably the first one that I really remember in terms of like seeing like a use of pop music in a film that really struck me was American Werewolf in London. Right, and the way that John Landis used.
Oh, there's a lovely doo-wop song that appears in it as well.
Yeah,
I honestly Marcel's. Who is it? No, I can't remember.
Marcel's version of Blue Moon. I honestly think it's the best song on an end credits ever, because it's not only the song is great, but it's so brutal the way it comes in out of a really tragic ending, cut to black, and then that doo-wop starts, and it like completely sends me every time. Yeah, I mean, I think the use of music in that film is sort of extraordinary, and I think, you know, like Scorsese obviously as well, like sort of, and then later Tarantino and I guess as well, like American Graffiti would be another one that the use of music in that, you know, as a diegetic soundtrack, you know, like.
Well, look, the traditional final question, it's been wonderful to talk to you, but you've obviously got a very busy day. Climax with talking to Scott.
I'm totally happy. This is fun for me.
I don't think your people would be. We traditionally finish by asking people to tell us what is the greatest record ever made. Is that something you've got an answer to?
Well, I tend to shuffle between a lot of ones that like sort of in. I mean, when I make these lists, it's sort of one of those things where you have different answers for different days. So, on different days, it might be like Abbey Road or Village Green Preservation Society or Orange, the John Spencer album with bell bottoms on it. But if I'm going to be on brand, and this is not me being cynical, because I do, it is like genuinely one of my favorite albums of all time, or one that I would, but I do think Sparks Kimono, My House.
I thought it might be. Fair enough.
An extraordinary album. And it's one of those albums as well, like every time you put it back on, you can't believe that it actually exists, because it's got this strange, I think it's that weird thing. And in context of the documentary, there was something that kind of occurred to me in terms of the context of it, is in the documentary, their previous two albums that they'd done as first Half Nelson and then Sparks had both been on Warner's and both kind of like tanked. And so then when Island gave them a lifeline, just Ron and Russell, they had to kind of leave the three other ones behind in the States. They're coming to London to do, you know, what may or may not be their last album, because if the third one doesn't do well, then that's kind of it. So with that in mind, I think the sort of ferocity in Kimono My House in terms of it being like a last stitch effort is so extraordinary. And it's also one of those movies like, a good Freudian slip there. It's one of those albums where like the first song is the most famous one, but then the rest of the album like sort of like maintains that level. And then once you get into the album, there's like album tracks that weren't singles on this, like Here in Heaven and Thank God It's Not Christmas and Talent Is an Asset and Hasta Mañana Monsieur. They're just like, it's like all killer. It's just one of those albums that I just think like there's not a duff track on it, and it just it is one of the greatest albums of the decade, but I would put like I would say this one today.
Well, there you go. No, absolutely fine. Edgar, it's been lovely to talk to you. You know, we can finally say good luck with the film. We've never said that on one of these before.
No, have we, Mark? No, thank this you. Is a first. Brilliant. Have a fantastic day today. Well, I think we want
Word in Your Attic, a Zoom with a View.